Thank you very much, Nick, and thank you, Dana, for the fantastic introduction to many of the concepts and questions that are important here. So I decided to split my talk in two halves, to begin with a case study in medical multi-omics or personalized oncology, to derive from that a couple of specific big data challenges that I see out there in the field, and then also to give you a little bit of background on the Bioconductor project and how it tries to address those challenges. So what I'm talking about is a collaboration between ourselves at EMBL, who are really basic science types and bioinformatics people, and the University Hospital in Heidelberg, together with a network of clinicians throughout the country that look at B-cell derived malignancies. So the team of clinicians, Thorsten, Leo, and Sasha, who are really very energetically pushing forward these studies, and then on our end, Simon and Gosha. So the starting point really is the observation in CLL, which is the most prevalent adult leukemia. It's a very refractory disease with a heterogeneous response and outcome. We know quite a little now about it, of course, over the last decades from microarrays, copy number arrays, genome sequencing. We have assembled quite a good body of knowledge about the molecular alterations in this disease. And for instance, the recent stratification of the disease by Davide Rossi is shown here, where you can see the different strata, different subtypes of the disease defined by the major molecular alterations that are observed in there. And so that gives you sort of a picture of how refractory it is. Now, the disappointing, now you might actually ask, how does this information that we have translate into treatment decision? And actually the answer here is quite disappointing right now. The only thing which is really used in current standard of care, at least in Germany, is the P53 status of the tumor that determines somehow on the choice of chemotherapy. But all the other information which we have about these recurrent molecular aberrations are currently, in fact, not used by clinicians. So the starting point really is to change that. So in our study, we basically start out with a large cohort of CLLs and other lymphoproliferative diseases. As they basically walk into the clinic, they get the usual omics spiel of all the different layers of genetic transcriptomics and epigenetic characterization of the tumors and of the germline genomes. And at the same time, we do high-throughput assays on drug response in vitro. So the tumors, the blood tumors, are quite easy to extract, even over multiple time points. They live outside the body for a couple of days, so long enough to do experiments on them. And then we basically can do viability assays or even more sophisticated assays on them. Just to give you an overview of the kind of data that we have, so the main focus right now is on the sort of large and wide screen. So we use a focused set of drugs that are important in cancer on a large panel of patients, where really the focus is on the discovery of patterns of response as they go with the tumor properties. And sort of a second dimension shown on the left would be just basically screening large libraries of drugs for new novel effects and patterns. Sort of an example of the raw data I shown on the left-hand side in these bee swarm plots. And there, so you see that we see a quite very significant difference in the responses. For instance, in this case, so each point here corresponds to a different tumor. On the y-axis, you see the viability of the cells under the treatment with this drug, which is in fact one of the standard chemotherapeutics used in this disease. And I now split the data into two blocks depending on the P53 status. And not surprisingly, well, actually, we see a systematic difference between tumors, but actually also a large distribution of responses within each group, which of course just reflects that the biology is more complicated than just a binary classification. But even this binary classification effect now already reproduces what we see in the clinic. And the outcome, in fact, with the current treatment regimen that are chemotherapy-based in the clinic, and patients are shown on the right-hand side. And you can sort of see how the assay ex vivo, despite all of the things that you might worry about in an assay, reflects quite well the clinical outcome. And another encouraging aspect is that if you, for instance, cluster drugs by their similarity across across patients, that drug clustering, which is purely phenotype-based, actually very precisely and accurately reflects the mechanism of action of these drugs. And we can then find clusters of co-drugs that really mirror each other in their responses, and that typically corresponds to reflects that they have very similar mechanisms of actions. And we can even drive this forward. So for instance, the, one of the clusters that you see on top are all drugs that are targeting the B cell receptor. And so they cluster together. But they also actually included a drug which is which was thought to be a check inhibitor, which is a check inhibitor. But then actually digging further into these data and into the, this particular compound, we could then also see that it has an off-target effect into Src kinases. And that will, in this case, most likely explain that sort of the off-target effect on the B cell receptor here, and so on. So, in fact, going beyond chemotherapy, targeted drugs are one way of getting rid of much of the toxicity. And thus, since B cell derived leukemias depend a lot in their proliferation on the B cell receptor, that is an attractive target. So we have these cartoons that sort of reflect our current knowledge of how the receptor works. I want to point out three things here. Of course, the cartoon is imperfect. There may be many missing players. We're probably missing 3D geometry and lots of things. It will be different in every single patient. So having a single map of this won't be enough. We really want to map it out on a per patient level. And the third thing is we have, of course, now fantastic perturbation devices that now interfere with these pathways in the actual tumor, which are in fact drugs, which we can use to perturb individual players here, and in this way, figure out how the system works. Well, and we can now do this. So what you see here is simply an overview of the data. So basically taking all the drugs, all the important mutations that we observe in the tumors, do the sort of the pairwise association tests, and this table is simply a summary. Maybe the main thing, that sort of point I want to make here is IGHV, the immunoglobulin heavy chain, is a known sort of very important factor in this disease, and so it's not surprising to find many drugs associating with that. But in fact, there's other molecular aberrations, deletion 11 and trisomy 12, which are known from the clinic to occur a lot, but have right now sort of not very clear molecular significance, and it's quite exciting to see so many drugs associating them with them, which gives us a lot of hints on what they're actually doing. So currently, the two main dimensions, so Dana gave this very nice sort of picture of multidimensional spaces in which tissues and cell types live. In CLL, sort of the two main dimensions that we're currently thinking about medically is the P53 status and the IGHV status, and sort of they also determine drug responses to these classes of drugs. But in fact, there are more dimensions. And so just as one example, we see a very clear mTOR-related signal, which is a different signaling pathway that seems to determine the response to sort of classes of drugs. And for instance, here in this case, we actually see some kind of mutual exclusivity that some tumors seem to depend more on BCR signaling and some tumors seem to depend more on mTOR signaling. And that, of course, directly has implications for how we would treat them. Try to take this a little bit further. So what we do here, so what I'm showing you here, in fact, is one of these data overviews, all the drugs that are associated with BCR signaling, and just take the matrix of responses, order them through a one-dimensional linear embedding method, and what you then see is that we see broadly, now I need to point, we see broadly an enrichment of tumors with a certain IGHV status up here, the enrichment down here, which is expected. But besides many cases where we actually have patients in the wrong place or where the molecular annotation contradicts the phenotypic outcome. And this may be interesting cases because now the question is, of course, who's right? Is the genetics right, or like the measured markers, or are the phenotypes maybe more informative and could be used for that patient's treatment decisions? And we're currently trying to drive this further. So for instance, we use a multivariate high-dimensional machine learning method, like in this case, GLMNet, to basically predict for each patient their sort of IGHV likeness status from their phenotypic profile, and this will impute or correct the molecular measurements and replace them by sort of more robust ones. And it actually works. So what you see here is sort of the blue curves correspond to the P53 wild types, the green curves correspond to the P53 mutants. Sort of in the old days, there would just be the blue and the gray green curve, and they will be split by being good and bad. And if we now actually add this additional variable, which we get from the phenotypic screening, we can actually split up those larger groups and get a more specific subgroup. So that's really exciting starting point now. And obviously, so just very briefly, we're also integrating DNA methylation data. We're integrating also expression data with these, and so methods like sparse canonical correspondence analysis and so on, very good. Sort of find their usefulness here. Of course, the idea is to take this forward, well, back into the clinic. So we have this project, I think probably like several hospitals have it now, to have a sort of an online molecular characterization of the patient that is then processed bioinformatically, discussed by a tumor board consisting both of clinical experts and bioinformaticians and geneticists, and that they can basically lead to very rapid treatment decisions based on such kind of molecular results. Right, so what do we now get out of this for big data? Why did I talk about this specific project in my research? So one thing, actually echoing a little bit what Dana said, size doesn't really matter here. So the data set sizes, we don't really, I'm not worried about tables with billions of rows and processing them. I mean, that's in many ways a trivial task, just to find enough air conditioning to do that. What actually is the challenge, the heterogeneity of the data. As you have seen, we have RNA profiling, genome sequencing, the messiness of the data. So ideally, we would have exactly the same assay performed on all the patients and all of the different assays performed on the same patients. In practice, of course, that's not the case. For some patients, some assays are missing. Some assays are done maybe twice, a different quality. The technology has changed midstream, so machines get replaced, technicians or labs change. We have all of these problems with batch effects and normalization. The data don't really come, are not calibrated like meters and kilograms. They come in these funny arbitrary genomics units that are very lab specific and that need what people call normalization between them to actually even work with them. We have complex correlations in there. For instance, the drugs are, of course, not all different reagents. The drugs have very clear relationships between them, and it would be unwise not to ignore them. The same way the diseases, I mean, we have different known disease subtypes, and we want to use this information and we analyze the data. For these data types to make sense, the definitiveness matters. So very often, we talk about genome-wide technologies. So for instance, a technique is more interesting if it gives you an exhaustive list of measurements for a particular data type. For instance, all the genes, all the proteins, and so on. And data tables that are more sort of where the choice of variables was more haphazard tend to be also more annoying. And sort of the main point, or the one point that I also want to drive out of this is that the data need and actually have very little value without associated software to work on them. And that, of course, motivated what Nick already mentioned, the Bioconductor project, which is an open source and open contribution software project for the understanding of genomic data. We now started it already quite a while ago. It's based on a statistical language and environment R. And really, the main idea here is to lower the barrier of entry to adequate statistical methods for experimental scientists. And the idea how to do this, from the beginning, we knew that one single lab couldn't do this by themselves. So we needed sort of a distributed and decentralized development of interoperable components. And that really allows that different labs around the world don't really collaborate very much, but they can develop their own specific methods that are highly optimized for their expertise. But then those components, those packages, can still be assembled together into workflows and used by users in an almost seamless manner. So, and we want to integrate multiple data types. So you saw an example here with the drug screening results and maybe imaging readouts, genome sequences, RNA-seq profiles, and so on. Biology is moving very fast. The time is measured in weeks and months. So we need to be able to also rapidly develop methods. We want to get from an idea to a functioning prototype maybe in an afternoon. And that's also what we really try to encourage here. But at the same time, we also need a robust and durable publication and distribution platform for software. So the software, once it's sort of has a shape and is useful either for a paper or as a method, it needs to be published, it needs to be made available, and probably also needs to be stable for several years for the community. We're very keen on reproducible research, and I'll come back to this. Training is very important on both sides. We train computer scientists and mathematicians to learn more about biology, to actually, so they can actually write useful software. And we, of course, we train biologists and our clinical researchers to use the adequate statistical methods and sort of get more out of their experiments. The project is international, so here you see sort of a density map of user or websites visits, and you see the expected places on the US West and East Coast and in Europe and in Japan. Let me see. And it's actually has been amazing how the project grew from 15 packages in 2001 in a sort of this very nice way to now over 1,000 packages in it at the last release. So we have releases every 6 months. The releases are completely driven by calendar time, not by developers' concerns or so on. So every 6 months we have a new release. The software is tested again and sort of adjusted and bug fixed and documented so that we have a sort of always up-to-date offering. Motivating principles really are sort of two-pronged. We want to provide a compelling user experience, and that depends a lot on having good documentations. So having workflows and recipes out there that people can take up and sort of learn how to do something in a very short time. Package vignettes that explain what certain tools are supposed to do and what their spectrum of abilities is, as well as specific function man pages, which of course you need once you start programming with those packages. At the same time, and as important, is supporting an active and open developer community. So an open really here means that we're not limiting ourselves to a sort of an in-club of one or few labs that collaborate here, but the community is really open to anyone who wants to join. And we help these people. Our hope is to make users into programmers, developers, so we want to break down that barrier between developers and users. It also means we need to train the users. The code that we actually get from biologists often tends to be very functional. It produces good results, but often tends to be horrible from a point of view of computer science or software engineering. So we need to input some training here and support the distributed development of interoperable components by domain experts. And we need to do that to achieve this sort of nice goal. The key point is having common data structures that enable exchange of data objects between the different packages. This is simply a table from a recent review I wrote, some impact and data impact usage related statistics. So these are sort of very nice results that we get. It's very hard with an open source software to estimate how many users you actually have because we don't collect pings or a license or something else. But it looks like there's tens of thousands of users around the world, and there's a high activity and also usage of the software across science. Maybe the point I wanted to make here, for funding organizations also, if you think about that, it's actually very hard to measure impact and usage properly. And in a way, the more robust and the more sort of well-used the tool is, the more it becomes commoditized, the less people start citing it. And sort of there's sometimes an anti-correlation between how much a tool is cited and by how important it really is for everybody. Huh. Okay. Very good. So we publish software, and I really think of a software publication, of a package that I write or one of my collaborators writes, in the same way as thinking of a scientific publication. So the method that we produce should be reproducible, it should be peer-reviewed. That's why that means it needs to be open source. It needs to be easy to access by other researchers and society so they can critically examine and scrutinize it. We build on the work of others so we don't re-implement the same thing over again. We want to use what's already done and then just build interesting stuff on top of these things. And we hope and we write our things, our software in a way that will allow other people to again build on top of that. Software is dynamic, it needs maintenance and republication. That's a big difference to a paper. A paper, once you put it out, basically it's there, and you can more or less leave it in most cases. In our case, the data and the questions change so much and so rapidly that we have to keep updating things. So when I started, microarrays were all the rage, and like in Dana's case as well. But now, then of course, we had about 10 years ago the next generation sequencing revolution. Now third generation sequencing is sort of coming, and multi-omics is getting more and more important. And the data sizes are all together getting bigger. At the same time, software technology changes as well. So every year, the web becomes more usable, and visualizations using interactive websites and 3D things and the JavaScript and so on get more powerful. And of course, we need to adapt our statistical environments also in this way. Another actual challenge that's substantial or interesting is the one that we're used to still in a world perhaps where computers got faster every 18 months by Moore's law. They still do, but they don't do so by having faster clock cycles. Now we simply increase the number of cores with this basically constant clock cycles speeds of the CPUs. So we need to adjust the algorithms to make more use of this parallelism. And of course, as everybody knows, the cloud is getting more and more important as a place to provide software and storage. Final slides, show me the code. So I think so. A paper, and even the word says it, the printed piece of paper of a genomic analysis is really just an advertisement of what you did. The actual work is contained in the code. And if you want to really share that with your collaborators or with the scientific community, the code belongs to it. And I'm sure you're probably all aware of the discussions about reproducibility and reproducible research. And that is a very important topic. It has also many subtleties to actually implement this once you think about collaborative development and parallel computing and using of site-specific resources. A nice example recently was the ENCODE project that really published their paper that was accompanied by virtual machines, each of which would reproduce a certain figure in the paper. So you didn't only have to believe the printed paper in nature and the plots, but you could go back, you could download those virtual machines, actually follow the computations and examine what they did. And in the same sense, also the papers from my own group and my collaborations are now always accompanied by fully reproducible executable documents. And it's actually quite easy using, for instance, R and Bioconductor to prepare these reproducible documents. And that really helps also us a lot to safeguard the sort of correctness and quality of the science done there. So with this, I would like to thank my collaborators on these projects, especially Robert Gentleman and Martin Morgan, for their great input, and you for your attention.